The fulsome dedication of the musical offering marked Bach's swan song as far as formal dedications were concerned, certainly dedications of this type. From now on, he would write music almost exclusively for himself, or rather for the sake of the art itself, which he would now at last explore, unhampered by anyone's expectations of him. But even this isn't quite true. His overriding priority from now on was to write music solely for the glory of God and in the unfettered pursuit of what he understood to be musical, hence spiritual, truth. The dedications he did attach to his final works were to like-minded men who could be counted on to understand and appreciate the true nature of his innermost artistic quest. As he approached his middle 60s, Bach began encountering physical problems, well, one physical problem in particular, which made the pursuit of that quest increasingly difficult. As his son, Carl Philipp Emanuel, points out, its roots lay in the distant past.
His naturally somewhat weak eyesight, further weakened by his unheard-of zeal in studying, which made him, particularly in his youth, sit at work the whole night through, led in his last years to an eye disease. He wished to rid himself of this by an operation, partly out of a desire to be of further service to God and his neighbour, with his other spiritual and bodily powers, which were still vigorous, and partly on the advice of some of his friends, who placed great confidence in an oculist who had recently arrived in Leipzig.
The man in question was a Dr. John Taylor, an Englishman who prided himself, among other things, on such unlikely qualifications as his work with such singular animals, to use his own phrase, as dromedaries and camels. But he was no quack. He enjoyed widespread admiration, both in England and abroad, and his presence in Leipzig aroused great interest. He did operate on Bach, and readers of a respected Berlin newspaper were pleased to find his success confirmed by an article datelined Leipzig, April the 4th.
This Saturday passed, and again last night, the Chevalier Taylor gave public lectures at the concert hall in the presence of a considerable assembly of scholars and other important persons. The concourse of people who seek his aid is astonishing. Among others, he has operated upon Kapellmeister Bach, who, by a constant use of his eyes, had almost entirely deprived himself of their sight, and that with every success that could have been desired, so that he has recovered the full sharpness of his sight, an unspeakable piece of good fortune that many thousands of people will be very far from begrudging this world-famous composer, and for which they cannot sufficiently thank Dr. Taylor. Owing to the numerous engagements the latter is obliged to discharge here, he will not be able to proceed to Berlin before the end of this week.
But he was trading in false hopes. Bach had not by any means recovered the full sharpness of his sight. In fact, he'd lost it altogether and was now totally blind. And there was more, as CPE pointed out.
Not only could he no longer use his eyes, but his whole system, which was otherwise thoroughly healthy, was completely overthrown by the operation, and by the addition of harmful medicaments and other things, so that, thereafter, he was almost continuously ill for full half a year. 10 days before his death, his eyes suddenly seemed better, so that one morning he could see quite well again, and could also again endure the light. But a few hours later he suffered a stroke, and this was followed by a raging fever, as a victim of which, despite every possible care given him by two of the most skillful physicians of Leipzig, on July the 28th, 1750, a little after 8:15 in the evening, in the 66th year of his life, he quietly and peacefully, by the merit of his Redeemer, departed this life.
The greatest composer who had ever lived was buried in the cemetery of St. John's, Leipzig, without so much as a gravestone to identify the spot. By the early 19th century, when Bach's immediate family had all died, no one could remember just where he was buried. Not until 1894 was the grave located. Bach's remains were then dug up and identified, but it wasn't until more than half a century later that they were at last afforded their final resting place in St. Thomas's Church, Leipzig, fully 200 years after the original burial. By that time, not only the Art of Fugue, but all of Bach's major works were familiar to musicians all over the world. His entire surviving output, running to well over 1,000 works, most of them masterpieces, had been published and closely studied, and there was no doubt in the minds of millions of music lovers the world over that he was the greatest composer who ever lived and ever would live. His music embraces virtually every aspect of human experience, but what it communicates more than anything else is a degree of joy and spiritual exaltation, a sense of exhilaration, of play, of dance, from the most serious to the most ecstatic, which has never been matched. The spirit of dance is in practically everything he wrote. Bach's spirituality is matched by his physicality. Again and again, he makes it very hard to sit still. "This is music to die for," said a colleague of mine after a performance of one of the cantatas, way before that phrase became a cliché. More importantly, this is music to live for. It's music of almost overpowering health. For many people, and I plead guilty to being one of them, Bach's music celebrates everything that's best about being alive. In the fullest sense of the word, it's life-enhancing. All the more so because it comes from a life which, looked at from the outside, was almost spectacularly ordinary, give or take 20 children. The amount of tedium in Bach's day-to-day life, particularly in his 27 years in Leipzig, the petty vexations of officialdom and uncomprehending bureaucrats, the frustrations of having to work with external resources which were usually way below his minimum requirements, none of this suggests the greatest fount of joy in musical history. His married life was almost infuriatingly happy and stable from a biographical point of view. There were no torrid love affairs, no unrequited passions, no tormenting inner strife. He was a businessman whose business was to churn out masterpieces, even if only a few around him realized what masterpieces they were. Outside of music and theology, he wasn't particularly well read. When would he have had time to be? He wasn't an intimate of the rich and famous. He was an averagely overweight, middle-class citizen who didn't look or talk like a genius. What was very striking indeed about his appearance, if the few portraits are to be believed, was the self-evidently incorruptible strength of that face. Apart from his genius, one thing that certainly was unusual about him, and it seems clear that he acknowledged this, was his quite phenomenal capacity for hard work, backed up by an energy that from this remove looks almost superhuman. And why not? Who but a Superman could possibly have created this?